Next speaker is Giuseppe.
So thank you very much for the introduction, and let me join the other speakers to thank the organizer for not giving up despite difficulties and setting up this nice meeting here, and also for giving me the opportunity of to talk. So, well, I even have the privilege to be the last speaker. I hope I don't disappoint too much expectations. So my talk will be about relation between a notion of, let's say, non-classicality, so to speak, which is called macrorealism, introduced by Leggett and Garg, and the idea of quantum non-disturbance as the, let's say, incompatibility notion connected to this macrorealism. And here I put the, my collaborators and the paper we published a couple of years ago. And I start right away by defining what macrorealism means and to give a bit of introduction and motivation to the topic. So this half thing here will be my only sort of philosophical part of the talk. The rest will be all essentially mathematics, but let's say the idea is that you define macroscopic realism as the idea that at any time there exists a definite value for all observables, at least when you talk of a macroscopic system, and that you can, in principle, measure this macroscopic value without disturbing it. Well, the idea is that you don't disturb it too much and the disturbance is negligible. But okay, so this was formalized by Leggett and Garg in this famous paper. But the thing is that this is possible. It's not like this word possible, maybe it's a bit of a problem, because in practically what we mean is that we are assuming at level of probability distribution, as you will see later, that the measurement that you do on Q at the time one will not disturb the statistics of Q at time two. So you cannot detect any disturbance. But in practice, any measurement you do will be actually disturbing, and this raises a so-called clumsiness loophole. Okay, so the idea is again that, well, for very small systems there is no question. Everybody believes that a single photon, when you measure it, you disturb it. But maybe when you have a very big massive object, you can actually do something like this, and maybe you can put a test this theory. Of course, you're not trying to disprove quantum mechanics or anything, just to see whether this principle holds or not. Okay, so this clumsiness loophole was also sort of treated in this paper here to see a way of going around it a little bit. That's the initial approach, but there have been more development in this. And here I also put a reference to a review of this topic, because I cannot cover everything, unfortunately, in this time. So, but this is a very nice review if you're interested in all the experiments that have been performed, all the issues, all the approaches, and so on. Okay, so just to give you a more concrete idea, I'm presenting a very simple example that in this case, you can actually see the violation of macrorealism in a single qubit. This is not surprising because, I mean, it's a very small system. It goes a bit contrary to the initial assumption already. But anyway, so the idea is that, let's say you have an initial state here and you perform a measurement at time t1 and another measurement at time t2. And there is two sequences. In this sequence, you are performing both measurements, and in the other sequence here, you don't perform anything. So you just evolve and then measure at q2, at t2. And the observable that you have here is sort of, well, in this case, it's given. Either you measure sigma z here or sigma x here. And the assumption of macrorealism essentially translates into this no signaling from past to future. And this has been mathematically explained very well in this recent paper here. So the idea is similar as in the Bell inequality setting. You take the marginal of your probability distribution. This is the settings 1, 2 and outcomes 1, 2. So if you trace out the first outputs, you should not detect whether you have performed the measurement or not. So 0 here means no measurement. S2 means that you can either measure or not. So actually here there is a typo, because there's, yeah, so, okay. So here, when you measure and sum over the outputs, you get the same as when you don't measure. And so essentially, you cannot detect the difference between these two sequences from the probability. And of course, this is a very strong assumption, which is violated by very simple systems in quantum mechanics, and also by classical systems that are subject to disturbing measurements. But okay, let's say for a qubit, this qubit example, the idea is that here you calculate the probability like this with the Born rule, essentially with chain of observables. And the same here. Here you have projector onto sigma z, then projector to sigma x, then projector to sigma z. And here only the projector to sigma x. Okay, this is because you are transforming, you know, the sigma x observable with the sigma z. Okay. So if you have an initial state, which is an eigenstate of z, then you don't detect anything because you see that essentially when you measure and you sum over the outputs, you are essentially tracing out these projectors here. So you get this, which is the same as for the other probability. And but if you have an eigenstate of sigma x, which is, you can see it as a superposition of sigma z eigenstates, then you can detect a difference because here when you sum over the outputs, you get 1/2. And here you, since you have eigenstate of sigma x, you get either 1 or 0. So this is the simple example. And now this was to introduce the topic. And now what is the motivation? The motivation is that, for example, in the scenario of non-locality or other similar things, one can also define a notion of incompatibility for the at the level of observables without referring to states. So this notion would be non-joint measurability in the spatial scenario. There have been many papers. I mean, I'm just citing some of them which are related to this joint measurability question. But of course, there is a lot more literature on this topic in the spatial scenario. But what about the macrorealism scenario here? Can we find a similar appropriate notion of quantum incompatibility connect with this scenario? So this is the question we are asking. And the candidate for this, it's also very clear because it's well known. But before going to this, I just introduced this thing that everybody probably knows, but just for setting also the notation. So there is a POVM here. That is a collection of positive operators that sum up to identity. And you calculate the probability according to the Born rule. And this is my notation for this. And then there is a quantum instrument, which is, the mapping, the post-measurement state that you obtain after measuring A. And so this is a collection of maps that sum up. So this is the total channel, sums up to a completely positive and trace-preserving map. And okay, there is the property that the adjoint map on the identity gives you the POVM element. And so the typical example is this so-called Ruder's rule, that is, you associate the post-measurement state as this sort of projected into the square root of AX. Sandwiched between these two things. And yes, so given these notions, the idea is that we want to use the notion of quantum non-disturbance, which is defined as follows. So you take an instrument, you make a sequence of two measurements, A and B, then you say that A does not disturb or admits a non-disturbing implementation of the sequence whenever you can find an instrument such that when you trace out outputs X in the sequence, you don't detect a difference. So let's say here you measure A, then you make this instrument, and then you measure B. And if you trace out the outputs, then that's the same as measuring B directly. For all outputs Y and for all states. So that's also important. And essentially, this can be translated into the Heisenberg picture, that you map, you give the total channel for the instrument A, you apply it to a POVM element of B, and you get the same thing. So it's sort of a fixed point of this map. So a note that A does not disturb B and B does not disturb A are two different conditions, but we can also have both of them, and then we indicate it like this. So this notion was studied very much in this paper, and they had a lot of they studied a lot of properties in connection with other notion of incompatibilities, and especially the obvious ones are these two, that these the two POVMs are commuting whenever the POVM elements commute for all pairs, and they are jointly measurable whenever there exists a joint POVM such that you can recover each of the two as a marginal. So if you sum over Y, you get A. If you sum over X, you get B for all X and Y. So, okay, this everything here is, I guess, well known. I'm not sure how familiar people are with this, but it's clear that you have this chain of implication. So commutativity implies two-way non-disturbance, which implies joint measurability. Actually, even one-way non-disturbance implies joint measurability, because if the two commute, then you apply the Ruder's rule, and this is a non-disturbing instrument. And if A is non-disturbing B, then the joint POVM is simply the non-disturbing instrument of A applied on B. So this is already a joint POVM. So another maybe remark is that if in these two sequence of two measurement scenario, if either A or B is projective, then the three notions coincide. And also the qubit POVMs are a bit of a special case, because this notion again coincide in many cases. But this is just a remark. So now from the definition itself, we can see the connection with macrorealism, because essentially the no signaling in time condition for a sequence of two measurements is the same as the definition of quantum non-disturbance. So let's say this A non-disturbing B is by definition this condition, and this condition is also by definition a no signaling in time condition, actually the only no signaling in time condition for a two measurement scenario, in which you have a sequence that at the first measurement you can either measure, not measure, or measure A, and in the second instant you can either not measure or measure B. So this is the, it clarifies that this is the correct notion probably. So what we did is to push this forward to longer sequences essentially. And so here I present as this observation a sequence of three measurements. And the idea is that you can translate the no signaling in time condition as a quantum non-disturbance condition. But in this case, then you will get rid of the initial preparation. So the idea is that these three, if you want to measure these three POVM Q1, Q2, Q3, they allow for a no signaling in time implementation for all states, if and only if there exist two instruments such that, this is more explanatory, that the Q1 does not disturb the sequence Q2, Q3, and at the same time, Q2 does not disturb Q3. But notice that here there is an instrument, so the instrument play an important role, that the E instrument of Q2 must be the same for these two conditions. So you have to find a non-disturbing implementation here, and with the same instrument, you define this joint POVM or this sequential POVM, and then Q1 must have a non-disturbing implementation for this. But if you satisfy this, then you can have macrorealism for all rho. Otherwise, you can find a rho for which this is violated. So this is maybe a picture of this scenario in which there is only two sequences you have to take into account. So the sequence in which you measure at time 2 and 3, or you measure at all of the three times. And so this is for three times. And the idea is that the idea of the proof is that the non-signaling time condition can be sort of reduced by using also out of time constraints, which is, let's say, non-signaling from future to past, which is obviously true also in quantum mechanics. And then you can get rid of many conditions, you end up with three of them. And the middle one, you can also get rid of it when you require that everything holds for all rho. So then you simplify it further and you get rid of, well, some of them here. Essentially, the sequence in which you don't measure in the middle, it's not important here. So as a remarks of this observation is that, first of all, the order is sort of given. So let's say at time one, you can either measure nothing or Q1, at time two, nothing or Q2, and at time three, nothing or Q3, you cannot mix these things. And in this scenario, the two conditions are independent. Another remark, as I said, is that we are optimizing over states to have a state-independent condition and also over instruments. So we want to have, let's say, minimally disturbing instrument. And a third remark is that if we just take these three POVMs, but we can apply them in the order we want, then we have even the second one becomes redundant. Even this one becomes redundant. But okay, so this is just a different scenario. And then we also studied a more general case in which you have n sequences. And as you maybe would have guessed, the thing is that all the non-signaling time condition reduced to only these sequences in which n minus one before the n, and more like similarly to this, but with for a longer sequence. And that this set is minimal if you fix the order, but if you allow for permutations of these observables, then only the top one matters. So you have to check the top one for all permutations, and that's it. But in principle, you will have much more than conditions otherwise. Okay, so this was the connection between quantum non-disturbance and non-signaling in time. And then naturally also came the question, okay, but is there any structure between non-disturbance in longer sequences of measurements? And they didn't treat it the Hainosari-Wolf paper. So we tried to study this problem for longer sequences. And what we found out is first that, the remarks is that there exist two observables such that they are both in both ways non-disturbing, but yet non-commuting. I mean, this thing could so follows almost directly from Hainosari and Wolf result. And maybe less trivially, it also, you can also find a triple of POVMs such that they are pairwise non-disturbing in both directions. But still, if you put them in a sequence of three, then there is no non-disturbing implementation. So A will always disturb the sequence BC, even if individually and in pairs, they don't disturb each other. And so this is sort of analogous of the structure that arises for joint measurability as well. So this replicates this other notion. And on the other hand, this also resembles and actually strengthens the notion of colluding measurement introduced by Wild and Miesel. I mean, I didn't talk about this, but the idea of Wild and Miesel to sort of weaken the clumsiness loophole was, let's say, in a sequence of three measurement. Let me go here maybe. What you do is to decompose the second measurement into many steps, such that if you perform a single step in the middle rather than the full measurement, you don't detect any disturbance. But suddenly when you perform the full measurement, the full including all steps, then you see the disturbance. So then they call this colluding because individual measurements seemingly are not disturbing, but when you put them together, they are colluding. And here the idea is similar in a sense, because we see that if you perform sequences of two, you don't see any disturbance between any of the pairs, between any order. But if you put them in a longer sequence in a particular order, then you see a disturbance. And remember that here we are talking about all states. So either macrorealism is satisfied for all state, or you can find one state for which it's not satisfied. Okay, so this is, so with this notion, it also helped us to sort of argue about how to weaken the clumsiness loophole, in this sense that you can exploit, let's say, this kind of structure if you would be able to implement them in the experiment to sort of, let's say, violate macrorealism in a stronger way, in a sense, or I don't know, yeah. So, and I also want to give the idea of the proof, because most of the tools are taken from this Einosari and Wolf paper. And the main tool is actually this nice example they had of a POVM, which has the following properties, that it's given by POVM elements which don't commute, not all of them commute to each other, but yet there exists an instrument such that this A is a fixed, so A itself is a fixed point of its own instrument. This is called a repeatable measurement. And so essentially there is this very nice map, which has a fixed, I mean, it's nice, has nice properties of fixed points. And then you can construct, based on the same idea, you can construct then longer sequences with interesting properties. In this case, as I said, you can have, let's say, A does not disturb itself. And also you can find a B that has is not disturbed by A and does not disturb A. Actually, the B can be even rather trivial. It's everything commuting, even, let's say, trivial observable identity and zero. And so, but this would already work. So you would have something which does not disturb itself in both directions pairwise, but three-wise, let's say, in the triple-wise, you will still have a disturbance, because then when you put A and B in a sequence, suddenly A disturbs them, or if you put them in the opposite sequence also. So this does the job, but the point is that also that it cannot be, well, obviously it cannot be qubit, but the dimension must be 5 here. And we found another example in which the dimension is 3, which is sort of minimal, but then it also you don't fully get this. So one of these arrows is also missing. So there are 3 different observable now, A, B, and C. All of them are non-disturbing themselves, and almost all pairs don't disturb each other in both directions. And still you can find that they must disturb each other in the sequence of 3 of them. So this hints that there is quite a nice structure in longer sequences as well to explore. But okay, we stopped here in this work. And besides this, we also have, let's say, studied a little bit how can you quantify, let's say, the violation of macro the violation of macrorealism in a sense. And also this builds upon the what they had in the Henosari work paper. So the idea is to quantify the amount of violation of this non-disturbance condition. And to sum if you have a sequence of 2 observables, you sum how much Q1 disturbs Q2 plus how much Q2 disturbs Q1. I mean, the minimal amount of disturbance, so to speak. And this gives you a measure. And of course, we defined it for arbitrary long sequences, but the expression looks a bit ugly, so I am not showing it here. I just show what are the free operations.
We are slowly running out of time.
Yeah, this is my last slide. Do I have one more minute or?
Yes, sure.
Yeah. So the free operation are just classical post-processing of the observable. Global means that you post-process all the observables at the same time. Or you can have a unitary channel on all of the observables at the same time, or you can have a global quantum qubit channel, or you can have this depolarizing channel. So these are the free operations we found. I'm not sure this is the full set, but at least this gives an idea what can you do for let's say, not increasing macrorealism. And that's it. So my last slide, I would just to thank you for your attention and thank my collaborators here as well, and point you out to the paper as well, again. So thanks.
Okay. Thank you. So first set of questions is from Remik. Remik, you wrote a lot in the chat, so maybe you can ask the question yourself instead of me reading this.
So at some point you said that also the classical measurements are disturbing. So in what sense was that?
In the sense that you can see a disturbance, so you can violate very, very easily this non-signaling in time condition, also with classical measurements. So this means that essentially you have no memory at all in the process. But if you have a very simple, like a single bit, in which when you measure, you flip the bit, that already violates this. And I mean, this is well known. People study this from this perspective as well. You can quantify the amount of disturbance, for example, by the amount of classical memory you have, you need, or things like this. But I mean, this is a kind of a different approach. Yeah. Does this answer your question?
Yes. Okay. So should I read another question of mine?
Yes, please read all of them.
So look, if you are given two POVMs, okay, which are incompatible, are you able to construct LG inequality which is violated by them? So I'm asking because, for instance, in the Bell scenario, I think that there are examples of POVMs which do not give rise to any locality.
No, yes, but I think here it's much more simple because here we don't have, like, the Bell inequality scenario. It's, the nothing in if you will think in that scenario, the non-signaling condition are actually a requirement that you have, while here the non-signaling condition is violated. So it's much simpler. So you immediately can see that you violate the non-signaling condition if you have two incompatible POVM. Actually, they by definition would you would have, the only thing is that you would have to find the state that shows you. But if you know that they are incompatible, probably you also know what is the state that tells you, that shows you this incompatibility. So the definition is here in equation 11, for example. So by definition, if you can find a row such that this does not hold, then you know that A and B are not compatible, are disturbing each other. And by definition, you are also violating a non-signaling in time condition. So the connection is much simpler in this case, I would say. Just that for longer sequences gets more messy because you need to play, so you be careful with the instruments that, but that's mostly to satisfy macrorealism, not to violate it actually.
And at some point you mentioned that if measurements are non-disturbing, they are also jointly measurable. So what about the opposite direction?
No, the opposite direction are not true.
Okay. Oh, so you have
Here the things are not true, and here you can see this even in the so this other direction. I don't have an example now, but for the commutativity direction, the example is simply this thing here. So this thing don't commute, but still they are non-disturbing.
Okay,
it does not disturb itself.
Thank you.
Okay, I guess this is it. There are no more questions. So. I would like to thank Giuseppe again, and on behalf of all the participants, I would like to thank the organizers for preparing and running this conference, especially in these conditions. Thank you guys very much.
Thank you, Marcin, and thank you for wearing your best suit and tie today for us.
Yeah. We feel honored, Marcin. Yeah, so, that's it, guys. Yeah, I think... our director would have some closing words.
I think our director on behalf of the organizers, I would like to thank all the participants and of course all our speakers and posters presenters for really amazing talks and amazing posters. Also, it's a good moment to thank Polish National Agency for Academic Exchange which gave us money last year to organize this workshop. And of course, we should not omit our technical support. So Oskar Słowik, who set up this Discord platform for our conference. So also thank you very much, Oskar.
Thank you very much for everyone. Take care and bye.